Good morning, everyone. So first, remember that the first homework is due this Thursday. So if you can start it or not yet really finished, start doing something. Okay. So otherwise, we were talking about the simplex algorithm, and we decided that once you have at least one feasible solution, the simplex algorithm works. It works reasonably fast and produces the optimal solution. So we'll talk today a little bit about the problems with this. Sometimes, well, there are some small problems in the simplex algorithm. But in the end of last class, we started talking about what to do if you have a problem we don't see immediately a feasible solution. So our example was, I'll simplify this time a little bit, but it was basically like this. Oh, actually, before I go to the tensile material and calculations, I must make a correction. So last time I did switch the basic and basic variables in my mind, so I must tell once again what the basic variables and what are not. So let me record the correction. And they're more formulated than words, so I'll just give an example and you'll see by analogy what is in general basic and what non-basic means. So if you want to maximize something like 7 minus 3 xv plus 5 xy and subject to x1 is 5 plus 5 x3 minus 3 x5, x2 is 3 plus x3 plus x5. The numbers are pretty random, so the important thing is just the variables. And you want all the variables to be positive. So that's a typical iteration in the simple side. A typical iteration, well, del 0. At this point, first of all, at this point, all variables do we assume are equal to 0. So which constraints can we push to their limits at this point? So, of course, x3 and x5 is equal to 0. That's what we kind of push to their limits. And accordingly, we say that at this point, we found value of z, which is 7. And this point itself is x1 is equal to 5, x2 is equal to 3, x3 is equal to 0, x4 is equal to 2, and x5 is equal to 0. So this information basically encodes the whole step. It basically encodes all the information you have on the problem up to this step in the algorithm. And just this amount of information is called the dictionary. And I'm not completely sure what it translates to what, but it's typically called a dictionary, and maybe you can say it translates information about these non-basic variables, information about basic ones. So, I mean, it's a little bit strange to say, but anyway, it is called a dictionary, so once you perform an iteration of simplex algorithm, you create a dictionary. And in this case, the x3 and x5 are called non-basic variables, and the ones that appear here x1, x2, x4 are called basic. And of course, at each iteration of the simplex algorithm, one of the non-basic variables becomes basic, and vice versa, one of the basic variables becomes non-basic. So you increase one of the variables and push one of the corresponding constraints. Well, that's you. That's what happens. So, well, maybe it's some kind of way to remember which ones are basic, which are non-basic. So non-basic sounds like they are not really important, and they are actually kind of zero in this case. So maybe that's a way to remember. We'll have a different way to remember, well, once we talk about the linear algebraic interpretation of this right in terms of matrices, and it will be more mathematical way to remember which are basic, which are non-basic. But for now, let's just accept this terminology. Okay, so this is about, well, just words, no mathematics here. Let's go back to mathematics. So let's try to solve such a problem. Maximize, we have something which has two variables, x1 plus x2, subject to x1 minus x2 smaller equal to minus 1, minus x1 minus x2 smaller equal to negative 3, and let's say x2 smaller equal to 4, and of course x1 and x2 above all. So I want to solve this problem, and the problem that it is our usual first attempt, x1 equal to 0, x2 equal to 0, our most main attempt at finding this feasible solution doesn't work here. The origin is not feasible here. It's not a solution because it violates two constraints. So our solution last time was, well, let's relax these constraints by, let's make it smaller equal not than minus 1, but smaller equal than minus 1 plus some number. And let's make this number b. Well, and then we'll try to find the smallest number by which we can increase the right-hand side in such a way that it will be possible to find a solution. So we decided to do the following. So to find at least one feasible solution, so the following system first. We'll try, first of all, we'll try to relax these constraints, x1 minus x2. Well, it itself might not be smaller than minus 1, but let's subtract a large number, x3, and make it smaller than minus 1. Let's, instead of minus 1 minus x2, well, once again, it would be not smaller or equal than minus 3. Let's subtract a large number and make it smaller than minus 3. And finally, x2 might be not smaller than 4. Let's subtract a number and make it smaller than 4. And let's agree that we subtract only positive numbers. Well, and actually, I don't really want to subtract a huge number. I just want to subtract a number which is as small as possible, ideally 0. So let's find the minimum of x3. So smallest number by which I can realize this inequality, so that they will have a solution. Okay. So that's our idea how to find a feasible solution. And first of all, let me make a small comment. It looks like we are doing something wrong. It looks like, I mean, conceptually wrong. We are starting with a complicated problem. You maximize, well, find the optimum of a function subject to several constraints. Well, this looks like a complicated problem. The problem of finding just one solution sounds like kind of simple problem. I mean, okay, so we have some constraints. You just want to find some combination of numbers. It's not about the largest value of this thing among infinite many solutions. No, it's just one single number. So why should we kind of have to solve another problem, another minimization problem, which is as complicated as the original one, just as a first step? Well, the answer is that we can actually show that knowing how to find just one solution to a system of inequalities, well, is actually equivalent to knowing how to solve any minimization or maximization problem. So we are not going to do this, but at least conceptually, these problems are of equal difficulty. I mean, one of them sounds simpler than the other one, but actually, from kind of computation theoretical viewpoint, they are exactly the same difficulty. Once you know how to solve one of those, you can get an algorithm for solving another one, which runs in approximately the same amount of time. So this solution, I mean, it does sound a little bit artificial, but well, it is in a way one of the best ones. Okay, so let's try to solve this problem. And for this, first of all, let's create our first dictionary. Now we know the word. So first of all, I want to minimize something. Well, that's not what I typically do. I usually maximize stuff. So instead of maximize, what? Minus this. So that's our usual step. Next thing, I'll introduce slack variables. The variables which tell me what is the discrepancy between left side and right side, each of the inequalities. So x4 will be minus 1, minus x1, plus x2, plus x3. x5 will be negative 3, plus x1, plus x2, plus x3. X6, okay, now we have lots of variables. So 4 minus x2 plus x3. Well, and I want all the variables to be positive. So that's an equivalent problem. I just rewrote this problem in this way, which looks like a dictionary. There is a problem with this dictionary. It does not correspond to a feasible solution. So usually, a dictionary corresponds to a solution. You make the non-basic variables equal to zero, and the basic variables, well, they become something, and typically it is a solution. Here it's not the case. If you make x1, x2, x3 equal to zero, well, x4 will become minus 1, which is not good. Similarly, x5 will become minus 3, which is not good. Well, but that's something to be expected in this kind of problem. We just translated a problem which didn't have a feasible solution. Well, now we have a problem which still doesn't have a feasible solution, obvious one. But we did allow ourselves some allowance, some tolerance. We did allow ourselves to choose x3. Well, it means that we'll have to choose x3 to be kind of, I mean, non-zero, so it means that it will become basic in the next step. And one of these variables, x4, x5, x6, the one which imposes on x3 the most strict condition, well, will become zero. So let's see. If I want x4, x5, and x6 to be positive, so I'll take my x1 and x2 to be zero. First step, I take my x1 equal to 0, x2 equal to 0. This will be non-basics. X3 at the next step will become basic. So for now it's not basic, but well, it's not what we actually wanted. If it is 0, then it's not a feasible solution. So let's see. X3 must be what? So from the first inequality, I see that it must be at least 1. Once you make it at least 1, x4 becomes positive. So x4 being positive. Second thing, minus 3 plus x3 becomes positive when x3 is greater or equal than 3. And finally, x6 is already, well, positive, even if, well, whatever value of x3 you have. So, bigger or equal than 0 from x6 being positive. So it doesn't matter. Even if it is 0, x6 is already 4. Okay, so which of these is the strictest inequality? 3, of course, 3. So we see that x5 will become zero once we make x3 into 3. Yes.
Why did you take x1 and x2 to be zero from the first step?
So my default solution would be x1, x2, x3 equal to zero. Once I see these problems, this dictionary, my default attempt is x1, x2, x3 equal to zero, and the left side adjusts accordingly. Well, but now I see that it's not really a good thing. Once I let those be equal to zero, x4, x5, x6 adjust to non-feasible solution. And I already thought about a strategy how to find a feasible solution. In this step, translating this problem, finding a solution to these equations, to this problem, I allowed myself some variable x3, which I a priori knew that once x3 is big enough, I will be able to find a solution. So to find a solution, I will still keep those variables at zero, and I'll increase x3 until I find a solution. So that's exactly a typical iteration of the syntax algorithm. Except here we start not with a feasible solution and try to improve the objective function. Here we start with infeasible solution and try to make it feasible. But still, it's exactly the same. I keep all of my non-basic variables zero, and I increase one of them and becomes basic for the next step. Okay, so I decided to increase x3 to zero, to 3, and x5 will become 0. So in next step, I will have to express everything in terms of x1, x2, and x5. Those will be the non-basic variables. Okay, so first task is, for now, everything is expressed in terms of x1, x2, x3. Express x3 in terms of x1, x2, x5, in terms of the new non-basic variables. So x3, let's see. So this inequality was this inequality. So I'll use this one. So x3 is 3 plus 3 plus minus x1 minus x2 minus x5. So just take x3 and use this equality.
Should we plus x5?
Plus x5, yes. Thank you. So I move this to the left. Okay. Then I'll have still x4 and x6. X4 is minus 1, minus x1, plus x2. Instead of plus x3, I'll use this equality. Plus 3 minus x1 minus x2 plus x5. So now it is 2 minus x1 minus another x1 minus 2x1 plus x2 minus x2. Nothing. And plus x1. Similarly, x6 will be 4 minus x2 plus x3 minus x2 plus x3 is 3 minus x1 minus x2 plus x5. So it is 7 minus x1 minus 2x2 and plus x5. And perhaps most importantly, z is minus x3, and so it is minus x3. So it's minus 3 plus x1 plus x5, x2 minus x5. My first step of a syntax algorithm was a little bit unusual. Not only I did not increase the value of x3, I didn't have a value of x3 to of z. I didn't have a value of z to start with. And instead I went from infeasible solution to my first feasible solution. Now x3 is equal to 3, x4 is equal to 2, x6 is equal to 7. And once you assign these numbers to these variables, so x1, x5, x1, x2, x5 are equal to 0, well, then becomes minus 3. Which basically just corresponds to the fact that if you increase the right sides here by 3, well, you'll get an obvious solution, 0, 0. So basically we did, well, just a tiny bit. But now we can improve on this. How? Well, we see that if I try to increase x1 or x2, the value of z will become larger. Which one to choose? Well, they both have coefficient 1, so it's not obvious which one gives you a better increase. Maybe a good idea would be to think, well, if I try to increase x1, how much will I be able to increase it? So up to 3, up to 1, up to 7, okay, so up to 1. So increasing x1 will give me an increase of z by just 1. What about x2? If I try to increase x2, I can increase it up to 3. I can increase it however I want, and up to 7 by 2. Okay, so by 3. So in fact, I will be able to increase x2 by 3, so the value of z will increase once again by 3. So it's better. So let's increase x2. How much can I increase it? Well, we just said from x3 being bigger than 0, it can increase up to 3, from x3 being bigger than 0, or up to 7 by 2 from x6 being positive. This inequality is the strictest one. 3 is smaller than 7 over 2. And so my new non-basic variable will become x6, if it will go to the right.
Sorry,
why
x2?
So I just looked at the system and I saw, well, first of all, I have a tie here in the coefficients, so I don't really see from here. But then, how much can I increase x1? I see from here that I can increase it up to 3, up to 1, or up to 7. So only by 1. But x3 I can, x2 I can increase all the way up to 3. So it's better. Okay, so I want to increase it to 3. What happens to the these variables? So x6, x3 will become my new non-basic variable. I'll express everything in terms of x1, x3, and x5. So x3 will be, x2. I want to express x2 in terms of x3 and my previous variables, x1 and x5. So x2 is, from this equation, 3 minus x1 minus x3 plus x5. And then x4 used to be 2 minus 2x1 plus x5, didn't involve any x2, so it's still as it was, 2 minus 2x1 plus x5. Very good. And x6 now becomes 7 minus x1 minus 2 times x2, I'll have to use this expression. Plus x5. If I open the brackets, I get 1 minus 3x1 plus 2x3 minus finally, the most important thing is that, did I increase it enough? Well, that's minus 3 plus x1 plus x2, which is 3 minus x1 minus x3 plus x5 minus x5. So it is 0 plus x1 minus x1, 0 minus x3. And, well, plus x5 minus x5. Okay. Anyway, all better now, because now we have the following thing. Once I set x1, x3, x5 to 0, I get z which is equal to 0. Well, in fact, this expression was to be expected. If I want to express z in terms of x1, x3, and x5, well, I already have an expression in terms of those. It's just minus x3. Well, at least I didn't make a mistake. That's good. It is not here. Okay, so now I have indeed found a solution where z is equal to 0, which is exactly what I wanted. And of course, I cannot make it bigger just because minus x3 is always negative. So I found a feasible solution to this system. So let me go back to here. A feasible solution. I found it right here. What is x1? It is non-basic variable, so it is 0. What is x2? 3. Yes, once those are 0, x2 is equal to 3. Okay, and basically in this problem I don't care about x3, x4, x5, x6. x3 was my variable by which I realized the inequalities, and of course it is 0 now. It is non-basic. x4, x5, x6, there are the quantities, so I don't care about those. Okay, so now we have a feasible solution, and we want to start solving the new problem. Before we go to this problem, how to solve this one, maybe any questions about this part? So, let me just say words what was a little bit different from the usual simple solver. The very first step, this one, to go from here to here. In the usual simplex algorithm, a step increases the value of z and, well, changes one of the variables from being basic to non-basic and another one vice versa. Here it was different. We did not have a value for z, nothing, because we did not have a feasible solution. So the first step was to find a feasible solution by increasing one of the variables, in fact, this extra variable x3. Once you increase x3 enough, one of the constraints will become 0, and you'll get a usual feasible dictionary. That's the only important thing to remember about this kind of problems. Okay, so maybe any questions? Okay, so let's go back to this problem. Now we can forget completely about what we did. To find this feasible solution, because it is feasible. It's quite obvious to check that once you plug x1 equal to 0, x2 equal to 3, you do get 0 minus 3 is smaller than minus 1. Minus 0 minus 3 is exactly equal to minus 3. And 3 is smaller than 4. So this is
in a case where the solution is not at the end gradient non-feasible, what type of solution would you expect to see?
So if in this kind of thing you get that the optimal value of Z is minus 1, is that what you mean?
Yeah.
Okay, so if, say, you try to solve this problem, and in the end you get the optimal value of Z is not 0, it is minus 1. So then the original problem that doesn't have any solution, any feasible solution. It is quite possible for the problem not to have a feasible solution. So if you recall, the picture for the problem was about the intersection of half planes. A problem, two-dimensional problem, was about finding the region. One of the constraints was, say, everything to the left of this line. Another one is everything to the left of this line. And it could happen that the whole problem is invisible. It involves that also my solution should be to the right of this line. Well, there is nothing there. Nothing in the intersection of these three half planes. So there are problems which don't have any feasible solution. So if you try to solve such kind of problem, you'll find a value of Z in this kind of auxiliary problem, which is not zero, say minus one. What does it mean? It means that you have to relax these constraints by at least one to find at least one solution, which means relaxing a constraint means you're pushing these lines in this direction, in this direction, and in this direction. Once the three things will have a point in common, well, you solve the problem. You can solve the problem. But, I mean, here you'll have to push the constraints at least by one, if the optimal value of Z is minus one. So it is possible that the original problem does not have a feasible solution. In this case, the optimal value of the auxiliary problem will be strictly negative, will not be zero. And once you get a strictly negative number and this the optimal solution, well, you know the original one was infeasible. Okay. Was it what you wanted to ask, or did you want to ask about it? Okay. Good. Okay, so back to here. Now we have a feasible solution, and we want to initiate our simplex algorithm with this feasible solution. Once again, we have a situation which is not completely typical. Usually we start with solution 0, 0, and we know which variables are non-basic, x1, x2. Here, x1 will be non-basic, it is 0, but x2 will be basic. It is not 0. But something else will have to be non-basic. Something else will be 0. Let's see what. Introduce our usual fix instead of variables. X3 is equal to minus 1 minus x1 plus x2. x4 will be minus 3 plus x1 plus x2. x5 will be 4 minus x2. Now I'm reusing the same notation x3, x4, x5, but they don't have anything in common with the previous ones. So now I just forgot about the first of the algorithm. Well, now I see that once x1 is equal to 0 and x2 is equal to 3, what happens to the other variables? x3 is equal to minus 1 plus 3, 2, so it must be basic. x4 will be 0. Aha. So this will be non-basic, and this will be non-basic. And x5 will be 1. So it will be also basic. So you have to express everything now, but not in terms of x1, x2, like here, but rather in terms of x1 and x4. So basically, once again, we start with a dictionary, which is not feasible. If you make this variable 0, you get minus 1, minus 3, 4, which is not feasible. But now you do know how to make it, well, what kind of iteration to make it feasible. Exactly this. So we'll increase x2 to 3, and x4 will become 0. So next step would be, we'll have to express x4 equal to 0, which is from here. So x2 is minus 3 plus x1 minus x4. And then I'll go x3 is equal to minus 1 minus x1 plus minus 3 plus x1 minus x4. X5 will be 4 minus x2, which is minus 3 plus x1 minus x4. And z will be x1 plus x2 minus 3 plus x1 minus x4. So this will be my first dictionary. Once again, this is my first step. First iteration.
Take x2 plus equal to 3 instead of negative
3. A x2 is equal to 3 minus 4. Yes. Okay. Okay, and now this dictionary is already feasible. Once x1 x4 equal to 0, you'll get these values of the corresponding variables, and it is a feasible dictionary.
Excuse me, can I just bring the bar a little bit up, please?
Yes. I won't solve this problem because from now it is just the usual syntax algorithm, and well, I think at this time pretty bored with just making computations. But this first step was once again a little bit not typical and important. So its goal was not increasing the value of z; it was just making the first dictionary feasible. And we achieved this by finding the non-basic variables, and one of those turned out to be set variable x4. Okay, so any questions about this one? So from here we just continue to syntax out. Nothing new. Yeah.
When we plug in this new feasible solution that we found, is it necessarily true that we will find two zero variables?
Mm-hmm. Yes. So basically, yes. Once you solve the auxiliary problem, you will find a solution which is not only feasible, it's also kind of in a corner. It is one that pushes several constraints to their limits, and you'll find select variables which are already zero. So basically, yes. Once you solve the auxiliary problem, you will find a feasible solution which is also like this. Enough variables to be zero. Let me show you the syntax algorithm. Yeah.
So when solving the auxiliary problem, when we got to the point where z equals negative x3, had that not happened, then that would mean that the actual problem we're trying to solve has no feasible solutions.
Mm-hmm. Yes. So if you get that, say, in the end, z is equal to minus 1 minus x5, and you see that it cannot ever be bigger than minus 1, it means that the original problem didn't have any solution. You have to relax the constraints to get at least one solution. Okay. So now we know. Yeah,
so do you actually have the solution to this, though, just so we can work it out ourselves?
The answer,
if you can just give us the...
I don't think so. I think, maybe. No, I don't. Sorry. Okay, so now we do know how to solve using syntax algorithm, basically any problem. In the optimization problem, we know how to initiate the simplex algorithm with at least one feasible solution by solving the zero problem. And we know how to proceed by doing the usual simplex algorithm. This is sometimes called the this process of solving two problems is called two-phase simplex algorithm. So first phase finds a feasible solution for you, and the second one starts with a feasible solution and proceeds to find the optimal one. Now, there is a slight problem. So we talked about the simplex algorithm. It usually works pretty well. At each step, the value of the objective function increases. Once it increases enough times, it becomes the largest possible, and we have an optimal solution. There is a small problem. Why should the actual variable increase at each step? Well, the obvious answer, because we make it increase at each step. But actually, there are some situations where the value of z doesn't increase that much. Actually, it increases exactly by zero, doesn't change. So let me see how you might, let me show how you might encounter this strange possibility. So we'll talk about degeneracy. We'll start with a problem which looks completely standard, completely usual. So we'll start with the dictionary. X4 is equal to 1 minus x2. x5 is 3 minus x1 minus 3 x2 minus x3. x6 is 5. Minus x1, minus 5 x2, minus x3, and z is 7, plus 3 x1, plus 5 x2, plus x3. So let's suppose that at some iteration of the simplex algorithm, we encounter the following dictionary. So here, x1, x2, x3 are non-basic, x4, x5, x6 are basic. So right now, our solution is, try x4, x5, x6 being 1, 3, 5. It makes z equal to 7, and try to improve from there. OK, let's indeed try to improve from there and see what happens. First of all, which variable will enter the basis? Which one is reasonable to increase from zero? F2, yes. It has the largest coefficient, so it looks reasonable to try to increase it first. Okay, so F2 will enter the basis. Which variable will leave the basis? Well, let's see. Once I try to increase it to 2, I will increase it to 1 from the first constraint, to 1 from the second constraint, so 3 divided by 3, and to 1 from the third constraint, 5 divided by 5. So there is something a little bit not equal. Usually, when we push the constraints to their limit, well, one of them is the strictest one. Here, no. All three of them give the same amount by which we increase x2. So either x4 or x5 or x6 will leave the basis. So now you have a choice. You have a tie. All three variables impose the same constraint. X2 is smaller than 1. Smaller or equal than 1. Well, we have a choice to make. I don't see any reason why I choose one over another, so let me choose the first one. Let's say X4. So now I decided that X4 will be a new non-basic variable to express everything in terms of X4 and X1, X3. Okay, let's do this. So from first equation we see that X2 is 1 minus X4. From second equation I see that X5 is 3 minus X1 minus 3 times X2, which is 1 minus X4, minus X3. So E is 3 minus 3 is 0, minus X1 plus X4, plus 3X4. X6 is 5 minus X1, minus 5 times 1 minus X4, minus X3, so it is 0, minus X1, plus 5X4, and minus X3. And finally Z is 7 plus 3 X1 plus 5 times 1 minus X4 plus X3, and then it is 12 plus 3 X1 minus 5 X4, oh no, yes, minus 5 X4. Very unusual. So it was unusual in the sense that we had to choose one of the variables from the constraints to leave the basis. Usually we don't have to make a choice, it is imposed on us. Here we could make different choices. But otherwise, well, the value of Z did increase from 7 to 12. We did make a very good decision. Now Z is 12. Okay, let's try the next one. So Z is now 12 plus 3x1 minus 5x4 plus x3. So which variable will enter the basis now? Yeah.
I have a question. You said Z is 12, right?
Yes.
So why are we setting the other ones to 0?
So once I write such a dictionary, it means that at this particular step, I assume that the variables on the right and on the basic are equal to 0. So x4 equal to 0, x1 equal to 0, x3 equal to 0, and the variables on the left adjust accordingly. So x2 is equal to 1, x5 is 3, x6 is 5, z is 0. So that's what happens in the simplex algorithm. You choose some of the variables to be equal to 0, they become the non-basic, you express all the other ones in terms of those. So let's try to increase Z from here. I see that I can increase it. I have 3 times X1 and 1 times X3. So it makes sense to try to increase X1. Okay, let's increase X1. First constraint doesn't involve x1 at all, so it doesn't tell anything. Second one, minus x1 plus some other stuff. Well, I actually cannot increase x1 up to 0 from x5 being positive. I already know that this will be the strictest constraint, but let's see what the other ones tell us. X6 being positive tells me that x1 is, once again, 0. So now I am in a weird kind of situation. I'm trying to increase x1, but I cannot. The other constraints tell me you can only increase x1 to 0. Situation. We try to increase x1, but we can't. But let's still try to do the iteration of the simplex algorithm. So even though we can't increase x1, something will change in the simplex algorithm. So let's choose, once again, in an arbitrary manner, let's say that I choose this constraint as the strictest one, and if they both involve the same condition, let's say that this one is the strictest one. So let me choose x5. Well, in fact, I could have chosen x5 or x6 to be the basis. And I know in arbitrary manner, choose x5 to be the basis. And now let's have a new dictionary. So I'll express. So x1 now becomes basic. And I'll use the second equation which imposed this constraint. So x1 will be 3x4 minus x3 minus x5. x2, 1 minus x4. So as it was, x6 is minus x1. Minus whatever it is, 3x4 minus 3 minus x5 plus 5x1 minus x3. So it is minus 3x4 plus 5, so it's 2x4 plus x3 minus x3, so 0 plus x5 plus x5. And z will 12 plus 3x1 minus 5x1 plus 6x1 is now basic, so I replace x1 by 3x4 minus x3, minus x5, minus 5x4, plus x3. So what happened, z did not increase. Z is still 12. Of course, I didn't change the value of my variable x1. Yeah.
In the line right above, mm-hmm. why is it only x5 or x6 that can be the basis?
Why is it what?
Why is it only x5 or x6 that can be the basis?
Okay, so the basic variables are x2, x5, x6.
Okay.
Then I try to see which one imposes the strictest constraint. The first one, x2, doesn't impose any constraint. So as far as X2 is concerned, I can increase X1 to 3 million, whatever. But X5 and X6 both tell me the same thing. You cannot increase X1 more than by 0. So basically, you cannot increase X1. So both impose the same constraint, and I'm free to choose any one of those as the strictest one.
Oh, okay.
Okay, so let's finish this computation. So 9 minus 5 is 4. Is 4. Minus 3 x 3. So minus 4 x 3. And minus 3 x 5. Okay, so this iteration is called degenerate. I did change something. So this dictionary is not the same as the previous one. The basic variables are now different, the non-basic variables are different. But the value of z did not increase. It used to be 12, and now it's still 12. Did I make any progress? Well, I don't know. I mean, I really have no way to measure this. I didn't do something. Was it a progress? I have no idea. But let's see what the next iteration does. Well, I'll try to increase x4. It's the only variable with positive coefficient here. Okay. How much can I increase x4? So yes, that's what I did. So now increase x4. Up to what? Well, first constraint tells me nothing. You can do whatever you want. Second constraint tells me increase x4 up to 1. Third constraint tells me so increase x4 to 1 from x2 being positive. And now I'm back to non-degenerate iteration. I do change some variable, some other variable becomes 0. My value of z will increase by 1 times 4, by 4. And now I'll continue. So once again, I will not go to the actual final step. But now, this iteration is non-degenerate. So now, after I perform this computation, I can tell you, yes, from this step to this step, I did make some progress. Because here I could not by any means increase the value of z, but from here I can. So from going from here to here, I did make some progress. It was very hard to measure before continuing the algorithm, because well, z did not increase, but still something happened. So sometimes these iterations are degenerate, which means the value of z does not increase. So degenerate iterations, well, they're not really nice. I mean, we don't feel that we make a progress, and in some problems we might make 20 iterations in a row, and they might all be degenerate, and we'll be kind of scared that, well, will we ever make an increase in that? And so there are two things I want to say. First thing is, if you start with a random problem, kind of choose the coefficients of the variables in a random fashion, say uniformly distributed from 0 to 1 or something like this, or Gaussian distributions, on the real solver, in any kind of reasonable random way, you will never encounter a degenerate iteration in the process. So they are really degenerate in the same, in the sense you have to work to construct an example with degenerate iteration. The other thing is, in practical problems, some, well, you do encounter degenerate iterations and frequently. So somehow the practical problems, they're not random in any way. They doing, I mean, some of their constraints might be kind of interdependent. They, too many constraints will impose the same conditions on the variables or something like this, it happens. Because, well, in many problems you'll get many of the coefficients to be 0, 1, or minus 1, and basically among those there are quite a lot of degenerate ones.
Is there a possibility, because we got to choose whether x5 or x6, right?
Mm-hmm.
Is there a possibility that if we choose one of them, we're going to stay at a number and the other one will increase, so then will we ever have to backtrack on our work for this?
So what could happen, so at this, let's look at this example.
Mm-hmm.
So suppose that x5 tells me it cannot increase x1.
Yeah.
Well, x6 can tell you either a less strict constraint, and then you have to choose x5,
yeah,
or it can choose, or it can impose the same constraint.
Yeah, but in this case, we're given a choice to choose which variable enters the basis, right?
Mm-hmm.
So x5 or x6, is there a possibility that if we choose one variable over another to enter the basis, that we'll get, like, we'll split into two different results, and when
yes.
One of them will not increase the value, then the other one will, and then we will have to backtrack to normal.
So
if we move forward on the problem, we would never have to go back and test out the other variable.
So basically what happens is, once both impose the same constraint zero, it means that both iterations will not increase the value of zero. Just because they both will not change the sum.
Mm-hmm.
So both will be degenerate.
Mm-hmm.
It could happen that one is, in a sense, more degenerate than the other. It could be that once you choose x5 to enter the basis, you'll make just one degenerate iteration and the next one will be not degenerate. But if you try to choose x6 to enter the basis, well, maybe the next five iterations will be all degenerate. It could happen. And there is no real way to know by just looking at the problem. So I'll tell about a really bad possibility and to complete but for now just about what the typical situation with degeneracy is. So a typical problem, once again, a random one will not have any degeneracies, a non-random one, kind of practical one, might have degeneracies. Next part, are degeneracies actually a problem? So, okay, we don't see that we make a progress, but maybe there is some kind of vague sense in which we are making a progress, we are after all changing something, and are we always guaranteed that the number of degenerate iterations will be finite? So, could it happen that we'll keep doing degenerate iterations? The answer is, in a way, yes. So, what happens here is, think about what simplex algorithm does. You have several variables, at each step you choose some subset of those to be non-basic, some other subset to be basic. Once you have a choice of which ones are basic, which ones are non-basic, you have a dictionary, basically expressed once in terms of the others, and you have an iteration of the simplex algorithm. So a simplex algorithm always moves between finite amount of states. Once again, the states correspond to choices of basic variables and non-basic variables. Each iteration, each pivoting, goes from one state to another. Usually, in a typical non-degenerate situation, you know that the next state is better than the other one because my objective function increases. In a degenerate one, the objective function does not change. Stays, has the same value. It is possible, well, then how is it possible that I will continue making degenerate iterations, but I have to go, well, to switch between a finite amount of states? So the only way is for the algorithm to cycle. So basically, if you have any algorithm, so you have a finite amount of states. I'll denote them by some kind of points. And let me locate the points at different values of the corresponding z. So here is, say, z equal to 0, z equal to 1, z equal to 5, z equal to 7. And these are the states of the simplex algorithm. Basically dictionaries. Choice of which variables are basic, which are non-basic. The simplex algorithm typically does the following. It goes from one state to a state with a higher value of z. That's a typical iteration. Well, it could happen that you make two typical iterations, but the next one is degenerate. It goes from a value of z which is equal to 5 to a value of z which is still equal to 5. Well, from here it has to go somewhere. If the value of z increases, it's okay. If it doesn't, well, you'll have to make a degenerate iteration that, say, it goes to here. The only way to do kind of lots and lots of degenerate iteration is to create a loop here. And it could be, could happen. So you make degenerate iteration and one more, and now you cycle. You go among five states indefinitely. That's not a good thing for an algorithm to go into a loop. But it is possible. So a simplex algorithm might cycle. Well, how unlikely is this cycling? Well, so first of all, once Danza created the simplex algorithm, he, well, suspected that it should work almost always. He thought about the problem of cycling, that it might never terminate, and he came up with a solution just in case. So I'll tell you what the solution is. But he didn't, he never, well, for some time he never saw an actual example of cycling, and some guys had to work hard to construct an example with cycling. It was kind of 11-dimensional and lots of constraints. But anyway, you can construct artificial examples of cycling. In practice, cycling is really hard to kind of encounter. I mean, it is extremely improbable to find a problem in which the simplex algorithm will cycle.
So will you put in the effort to create that question for us that cycles?
Sorry?
Will you put in the effort for us to put a question that cycles, or do we should just assume?
I can't ask you to come up with an example of a problem that cycles because it's extremely hard. It's kind of almost research question.
Well, you ask us a problem that cycles during exam.
Okay, so I'll tell you about the possible solutions to cycling, but basically I think that no. It's just important to understand that it is theoretically possible and that this problem has a solution, but I mean, once I tell you, I'll tell you two solutions and you'll be able to employ one of those to avoid being kind of cycling, always. So the lesson is, well, cycling might appear. It is quite improbable. In any sense of the word, you'll have to make a large amount of effort to come up with an example that actually cycles. For example, yesterday I tried and they couldn't. the book does contain an example, and it is an example that is quoted in several other sources, just because, well, nobody really thought about a different one, which is as small as this one. So it is quite improbable. Let me give you some geometrical intuition about how degeneracy might in general appear. So in two dimensions, we talked about the constraints being basically lines or half planes. How could several constraints suppose the same kind of condition? Well, suppose we have such a constraint. So typically, they give you, well, this point as their intersection. How could another constraint also give the same thing? Well, it will have to be a line which also passes through this point. I would say this is a new constraint. In this case, it is possible to go from this pair of constraints which give me this point to say this pair of constraints which gives me the same point. So in this sense, this kind of picture might create degeneracy. Or in three dimensions, you can think about a typical point being given by a intersection of three planes, a non-typical one, well, imagine something like four planes intersecting at one point. The thing is, such situation is not typical. If you change the plane just a little bit, if you change this line just a little bit, the intersection point, this kind of degenerate intersection point, will split to several. It will split to three. The actual value of my function at these three points will be almost the same if you move these lines just a little bit. So a solution to the problem for both degeneracy and cycling perturb the constraints. So in practice, it will mean, well, once you encounter several degenerate iterations, well, it could happen that you, well, are listening to cycle in the simple solver. But suppose that you have some constraints like this, x1 minus x3 is smaller or equal than 1, something like this. And this constraint somehow appears over and over and over, and somehow it creates for your problem. Well, change it a little bit. Instead of this, replace it by x1 minus x3. Well, in practice, it will be smaller than 0.1.00001, something like this. Some very small increase. Now you resolve the problem. Instead of three lines passing through one point, now you have three lines which almost pass through the same point, but not quite. They actually intersect in three different points. Now you completely resolve the changes. You will not increase that by kind of zero, you'll increase it by 0.00001, but it will be enough for you. It's not degenerate. Or, so in practice, this is the solution that some programs employ. Once they encounter, say, 20 iterations that are all degenerate, they change the coefficients by just whatever the floating point iterations allow them, and they continue the iterations, but now something does change. Now, these small increases resolve the problem of degeneracy. Once they get the solution, they know that it's not the exact one, it's only approximately, but the difference is it means place after the point, so it's not practically different. If you want a theoretically better solution, kind of this one actually doesn't solve the problem. It solves slightly different problem. In practice, it is enough. In theory, you increase it not by 0.0001, you increase it by an unknown amount, we call it, say, epsilon. And then once you solve this problem with the parameter epsilon, you let epsilon go to zero. So basically, you perturb, but not by one fixed amount, but by a whole family of numbers, which becomes smaller and smaller. So that's one of the solutions. I will not talk about kind of how to practically implement it. I won't ask any questions about this solution. But it is actually a solution. And this one is the solution that Danzig has in mind. Much later, there appeared another solution, which is called Blunt's pivoting rule. Another solution. This one will not prevent degeneracies, but it will prevent cycling. So degeneracies are bad, but not really bad. Cycling is really, really bad. So something to prevent cycling, and it's called Blunt's pivoting rule. It's also called smallest cycling. So it tells you how to break ties. So degeneracies might occur when you have tie in choice of the variable which enters the basis and in choice of the variable which leaves the basis. So if two of the variables pose the same condition, well, there might be a problem. So a solution is to choose the following. So once a tie in variables either entering or leaving the basis, mechanical way to choose a variable which enters and which leaves. So if you know that x4, x6, and x7 impose the strictest conditions, we'll choose x4, the one with smallest subscript. And surprisingly, the simple rule always avoids cycling. So we will not have a proof for this. It is somewhat complicated. There is a combinatorial proof to this, but it does always avoid cycling.
So when did the trying to find a variable in this case is then you look at the one with the strictest condition. And so it's not applied to the choice. What about entering? When did you try entering?
So if you have kind of set is x1 plus x2 plus x3. If you know which one to increase, finally this is
efficient. Yes.
This always
Yes.
Can I easily call x1, x3 at the beginning?
What do you mean?
Like, it's really useful, yeah. So, like, a variable number without a variable. I could easily call x1, x5, and x5 is smaller.
Yes. And you will do it without a number, and you will call it other fields as well, but you will also call it.
Come on.
Yeah,